I would like you to open to the book of Luke, chapter 15. I'm writing seriously on a new topic that I call recovering from spiritual bondage. And I've come to realize that one of the major things in recovery is knowledge. So open to Luke chapter 15. I should be dealing from verse 11 to 28, but I don't know if I will deal with all. Because I want to be done in 30 minutes. Are we there in Luke chapter 15? See what the knowledge of the truth can do. And it reads, and he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he who faint had filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of the hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let me stop at verse 24 when we start. And I'm talking about recovery from spiritual bondage. One of the things that it takes to recover from spiritual bondage that I want to stress on is understanding the truth. Or having knowledge of the truth. And that's what I want to talk about today. From the passage that we just read, the younger son, if you look at the passage, there were two sons in their father's house, and their father had everything that they needed. And there is no record that there were times that they asked their father for something and he concerned, he couldn't provide it. Their father had everything they needed, and so they had everything they needed. But the Bible says that one day, their younger son thought that he needed his portion of their father's wealth to be independent, to be successful, and to have freedom. Are you with me? The younger son thought within himself that he needed the portion of his father's wealth in order for him to be independent, in order for him to be successful, and to have freedom. Today, in the lives of many of us, we feel, think, and believe that what we need is wealth in order for us to be successful. We think we need wealth. We think we need some level of freedom to be on our own. You know, we need some independence in order to be successful. That's how we think. So many times you want to gather some stuff, and you feel like when you get all the stuff, then you are successful. So in this passage, this boy told of himself, look, Dad, I want my portion of your wealth. Now, why is it not for him or his father will, but he wants his portion. Many times, getting what we want in order to be called successful is not eating house. We are coveting things that belong to other people. We are covetous. Sometimes, even when you are a child of God and you are praying, you are just looking at things that other people have. And sometimes, if you just want to have what other people have without the purpose, without a purpose, you are covetous. It's like you even want a present thing to transfer to you. Are you understand what I'm saying? Yeah, you are being covetous. And then God looked at everything and said, look, God, give me my portion of your good because you bore me, so I'm entitled to everything. Thank God for where he was. But in Africa, the people feel that when they bore you, then you are responsible for them. But I think this God knew that because they gave birth to him, they are responsible for him. So thank God for his location. Praise the Lord. And so this boy asked for his portion. And in verse 13, I want us to look at verse 13 very keenly. In verse 13 of Luke chapter 15, the Bible says that he took all his portion and he went to a far country because he didn't want anyone to interfere with what he did with his wealth. He didn't want anyone to interfere with how he carried on his life. Are you with me, somebody? So he went to a far away country. He didn't want any interference. He wanted to do things by himself. He wanted freedom. And he carried everything he had. But, you know, as I was meditating on this thing, I was in America when I started writing on this topic called Recovery from Spiritual Bondage, and I wanted the chapters I'm writing on him. And, you know, I just looked at one friend, that verse 13 came in. He went to a far country with everything that he got from his father. And in one verse, just in one verse, then the Bible says he wasted everything on riotous living. In one verse, he took everything he had, and in the same verse, everything finished. People of God, what we need is not just material things. We really need knowledge from God. We need wisdom from God. We need grace from God. Because some of the things that you are praying for, if God gives it to you and you don't have the grace to sustain it, you're wasting in one verse. Not even in one chapter, but in one verse. One verse. The whole story started in verse 11. The men started grumbling in verse 12. In verse 13, they gave him everything. Everything finished in verse 13. Can you imagine that? independence that many Christians are going for, or many people are going for, Pastor Oka. They want independence where they want independence where they will just, you know, be on their own and gather some things and go. Imagine we got our independence since 1847. But if nobody pay rules, we won't give pay rules. So why are you talking independence for? If nobody sponsors the building of your room, even your ministry building, so what is your independence? Take it independent without knowledge. That's what it is. You grab, we want our independence. Some people even fought for the independence, but they can't do anything by themselves. Almost the whole Africa, every day they're going for one meeting, another place, and they say G8 meeting, this other meeting, and they are all asking what we go do for Africa. So why you couldn't remain under them? This means that true independence is not just having your own team. Independence, true independence is having the knowledge of God inside of you. This guy cried for independence. He took everything, but he didn't have the knowledge of God. So what happened? He wasted everything. Imagine you look at your iron ore, you look at your rubber, you look at your oil, you look at every other mineral, diamond, gold, and say, we want to be free. We don't want to put taking all of our things, and you make yourself free. And you got all the diamond and gold, everything, still you're a devil. You yourself in charge, you're a devil. I want us to know that we need to crave for knowledge. We need to ask God day by day for more of His grace. Sometimes you are even in your parents' house and you say you want independence. I'm tired of living here. I won't be on my own. You go on your own. You stay coming for help to your parents. So which independence you're crying for? Now that you're living with the man you saw and you say you died for it when you are with the man. And you still coming back to buy it, man. So what we need is not just what we call independence, what we call freedom to be on our own. Sometimes going on your own, you expose yourself more to the enemy to abuse you. Now look at this guy. The Bible said he went with all of his portion. And in the same breath, the Bible says he spent all on riotous living. What he got was more than what other people had in that country. And after he spent all, the Bible says that after he spent all, the famine arose. And when the famine came, he went to work for somebody to be feeding the person pig they were eating. I want you to catch what I'm saying. And when he went to that country, he had more than the man that employed him. He had more than the man that employed him. He had more than that man. And as much as he had more than the man, how come he became employee of somebody that had more money than him? He had more wealth than the man. But he came to the level of eating with pigs because what he called independence was not independence. If you don't have the knowledge of God and the grace of God for sustenance, you are deceiving yourself. And hear me, it's much more painful to be a wealthy person and then become a beggar than to be a beggar struggling to become wealthy. People who become wealthy and then come down, they easily commit suicide. The people who never got anything before at all. So every time, if you don't go for the grace of God and you want to run after things, you are exposing yourself to danger and to destruction. Look at our continent today. independence. Now he couldn't even survive by himself. He went as far as eating with pigs. People need to be asking God for knowledge. People need to be asking God for grace. And not just things. And not just things. We need some divine understanding. We need divine insight. You can get what other people have, and they will still be having what you lost everything. Today, we travel around Africa, you see that Africa trying to imitate the Western world. They want to build the same skyscrapers the people are building, build the same roads the people are building, but they can't imitate it. And it makes the place ugly more. They can't even be treated. What does it build a farm building like this, and when the window glass is broken, you can't replace it? You don't even have plan for every time a glass is broken to replace it. So when it's broken, remain like that, it becomes part of the fashion until all finish. All the people that are building the advanced roads abroad.
$6,000 for all the times they come into the country every week. Then you got to
and you provide God for the needs. This guy said, give me everything, give me my portion. He brought his portion and he went. And the Bible said, in the same verse, Pastor Oka, in the same verse, the guy lost everything. In the next verse, the guy was looking for people to help him to eat. So it's not just getting things, it's just looking for people to help him to eat. He became a beggar and started eating big food, going down to the level of eating big food. Then the Bible said when he came to himself, he said, well, how can I be here and my father got people in his house who eating bread and so much living over? And I'm here. And I don't even have anything to eat. I'm eating big food. How can I be here? I will arise and go to my father's house. And I will tell my father, let me be like one of your servants. Imagine a man that was son desiring to be like one of the servants. Because the servants have understanding more than him. Even servants knew why they were enjoying being attached to his father's company. And he, the owner of company, was detaching himself, looking for independence. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. And servants knew the prophet. They had knowledge, they had understanding, they had wisdom of how, what they were benefiting by being attached to the company as servants. And he being a son, a head of the company, was finding a way to disconnect himself. Many times when you lack knowledge, you lack understanding, you lack wisdom, you lack grace of God, you always think you're making the right decision by carrying yourself somewhere. And when he went away, servants became better than him. Servants, he went away with a great portion of wealth. Servants in his father's house were better than him. He came to his house and said, how can it be that servants in my father's house can eat sufficient and leave something? And yet, I'm eating big food. No, something is wrong. I will arise. I will go back to my father's house. Something came upon him. That what he needed from the beginning. It was what came at the end. And when he received what he needed and went back to his father's house, he enjoyed things that were more than what he carried with him. You hear me quiet? When he came back to his father's house, the father said, kill the fatted calf. When you are going, he never had a fatted. Number two, the father said, bring ring. He never went with gold ring on his finger. When he received the actual knowledge, the actual understanding, and the grace, he got better things than what he was craving for. And when he went back with knowledge and understanding, he never asked for those things. But the father said, bring it. Then listen, accepting grace when you are carried by revelation and by understanding, things will just come to you at the airport. I want to submit to you, go after grace. Go after grace. Go after grace. When you have that grace of God and you have the revelatory understanding of God in your life, too many good things will be attached to you than for you to be struggling for things. I tell you the truth, that life is easy. I was ministering a full gospel meeting the other time and I told him, I said, anytime you take your own agenda, you struggle. Anytime you leave God's agenda for your life, you take your own agenda, you struggle. I'm telling you. Why are you making it in a fashion? Imagine you are far younger than me, all your hair grew because you saw somebody being cattle and being cattle to the competition. You don't have the mandate to build cattle because everybody building upstairs school, high school, I'm not forced to do the same thing. If I will be having a social school, let me have a social school until God tells me go high. But I get this, my other men be in high school, my other men get this, my other men get that, so I must get it. No, you don't have the grace for that. It's always. That is not, it's not what God's agenda for you. And when you stick to God's agenda, other people people are stressing themselves out in life. You know what? There's so much stroke today. Because nobody wants to wait for their time. So all the young people get stroke now. Since two girls in the choir got married last year, no, we both get married this year. They didn't have any their pressure. Last year was their time. Your time is not this year. Why not wait for your time? Everywhere you think there is pressure because people going for things and there's no time for them. It's not your time. We preach this gospel faithfully. There are some people that follow me. We went places to preach without car until God Himself saw the need to start giving us car. We went to ST Number Church on 13th Street to preach. We preached the first time. After people say, oh man, God bless you, God bless you. We stood at the gate. They were telling me, God bless you. And the members didn't go in their car, they went. My wife and my deliverance team, we stood on the road. 13th Street to their car. And it was raining. And the pickup came. And we begged the pickup driver, my wife got in the front seat, and my deliverance team to the back of the pickup, and the rain flowed us from there to the red light. And I was just from preaching powerfully. When we got to the red light, it was late. We had to be running to get in Texas with the people there. And it was so late until some of the girls that we never knew had to say no people now. And one good man started talking to the other pastor. Yeah, they might be enjoying it. We pass from now and God see your kind of needs, He will meet your need. But you didn't say, God gave me that because my friend has car. No! God don't give people car like that. He doesn't give people car like that. Now when you force him to get a car like that, how will you meet in the car? Because God didn't give it to you. There was no need for the car. But God said, imagine a man like me, you're preaching and get to people for the rain flooding. Some of you don't even know who passed through the preaching in cars. Man, Bishop will get a car, I say, I want a car. Bishop will pay all, I say, I'll pay my horse. Like, whoa! If you're not careful, you won't even be able to climb the stairs because stroke will tell your teeth in the handcuff. It has been told you to get on the horse in front of you. And we won't finish. Stay no foundation level because you want to do it because others are doing it. Follow God's agenda for your life. He said, I want to go with my portion. Remember a portion, he became devil. With his portion, he became devil. The Bible says, and the Father divided his living. Everything he had, he divided into two. He said, there we have. And he became a devil. In one verse, anything like that God's agenda for you will make you to struggle. When he came to himself, that means everything he was doing was not to himself. Some of you, the things you are calling for, you are not even to yourself. Even the day you fight in the marriage, the woman you fight in the marriage, you are not even to yourself. When the true figure in your heart after the wedding, then you're not to yourself. I can't stand the kind of thing. I think I would tell you if I would die in my mouth, let me die there, but I can't stand the kind of thing. Then you're running back to your mouth. It's better you come to yourself now and know what God has for you. This time, Christianity has become the race that we're racing against each other. We are competing with one another. No, this is not Olympics. Christianity is not Olympics. That something that happened for somebody must happen for you too. No. You have your time. You have your time. God makes everything beautiful. In His time, the time that He has for you, make it beautiful. I'm telling you. Suicide. When your time comes, nobody will deny you. on your men and stay.
Yeah.
Enjoy one that side. You have plenty on this side. When we go there, we go on bigger platform.
Yes. Hallelujah.
While they are saving me, they want me to give me a horse. We are on different platform.
Okay.
I'm telling you, because it's God's time. Imagine you can move from here, you travel to America, then go to the Baba, the bishop came from there, me to your place, so I can. You let me have no garage to condemn you. I'm not sure I should condemn you, madam. Can you imagine that? All God left his wife here, traveled to the States, and he denied the last child, he said the last child he ever had before he went over. Just so you can have enough excuses to leave the woman and marry a different woman. And the woman used to cry like the whole world was against her. And God bless her. She traveled to the States on a big platform. She sang in concerts and preached in churches. And the guy saw her. He didn't even visit to speak to her. He stayed on the 3 a.m. She said, well, when you go home? Because right now nothing working for you. You see my platform ain't no cherries. You see, when your time comes, God will make you bigger than those that are ahead of you. Don't strive to be like that. That is why I like Hannah's story. That is why I like Hannah's story. You know Hannah's story? Hannah, imagine Hannah escorted Penina 10 times to Shiloh. I believe it's more than 10 times because she had 10 sons. So who knew her daughters were not there? Except she was a wonderful stepmother. Wonderful stepmother. So 10 times they went to Shiloh to make sacrifices. Every time they went, they had to dedicate another baby for her mate. Is that an easy way? 10 times! Now, the woman was praying until the pastor thought she was drunk. Because her prayer was different style, and the woman was shaking, was going in real prayer. But when God blessed Hannah with one, just Samuel. When Samuel showed up, the Penina had 10. But that one Samuel became the prophet for Penina 10. He became the priest for Penina 10. He became the king for Penina 10. And that is what God will do for you when your time comes. Your one breakthrough will be the king for the other people breakthrough. Yeah. Do you know how many prophets wanted to be like Elijah? Why Elijah was praying to God? One letter from one lady, Elijah was praying to God. Why so many prophets want to be like him, calling down fire? Sometimes you gotta be happy with where you are. While you are believing God for the next level, don't kill yourself for the next level. Don't kill yourself for the next level. Don't kill yourself. Don't create pressure for yourself. Don't create heart attack for yourself. Seek the knowledge of God, the wisdom of God, the grace of God. When you get somewhere by grace, you will manifest glory. Is controlled by your account.